this kind introduction, and thank you for welcoming me here and for this opportunity you offer me to return back to Ireland. You know that, as you said before, I spent a couple of years as ambassador of Cyprus. I was the first resident ambassador of Cyprus to Ireland, and this is an extraordinary moment in my personal and professional life, and I'm very proud of this. And me and my family, we keep very fond memories of our, you know, passage to Ireland. And it was not only because we were very warmly welcomed in Ireland, but also it was because it was crucial times for all of us. I was here at the time of the Good Friday Agreement. I was here at the moment when Cyprus, along with many other member states, started accession negotiations. And at the time, I mean, Ireland was doing very, very well. It was the best moments of the Celtic Tiger. And it was also, I mean, transformed in a feeling of real generosity. And I remember at the time all the political leaders of the country, when they were talking about enlargement, they were mentioning the idea that, you know, Ireland benefited from accession and it was time to give back. And we were, all of us, all candidate countries, and I shared this experience with many of my colleagues, were having the feeling of being embraced by the Irish people, by the Irish society, by the Irish leadership. And I'm really very grateful for this, and this is an opportunity for me to formally express my gratitude to Ireland and to Irish people. So time went by, and now Cyprus is in the European Union, and now it's time for us to assume this big responsibility, which is consubstantial to membership, which is assuming the rotating presidency of the Council of the European Union. We are starting on July 1st, so it's a bit more than 2 weeks away. And you know that the presidency has evolved after the Lisbon Treaty, but it has not lost its relevance and its importance. The role of the rotating presidency entails, among other things, of course, steering discussions within the Council, deciding on issues to be on the agenda, mediating and negotiating among member states in order to reach compromises and agreements in the Council, but also acting on behalf of the Council with other institutions, and in particular with the European Parliament, which under the Lisbon Treaty came out with increased powers and is the co-legislator in most areas. You know, negotiating with Parliament is one of the biggest challenges of rotating presidency since the entry into force of the Lisbon Treaty. We have utmost respect for the rights and the prerogatives of all European institutions, and our ambition is just to do the job right with full respect of the treaties. At the same time, there is a new role for the rotating presidency, which we didn't think about before, and is in light of this multiplication at the end of the day of the centers of power. You know, all over the years, we were trying to think that we needed to have a reply to Kissinger's question, which number you dial for Europe. but we ended up having even more centers of power than before, with the permanent president of the European Council, with the high representative, with increased powers, you know, in the European Parliament, with the Commission being very jealous about their own powers, and with the rotating presidency trying to play a role, and with the Franco-German engine coming back with the crisis and all those things. Therefore, there is probably for the rotating presidency a new role, and this role is about regulating and ensuring consistency and coherence within the system and among the various poles of the political power within the Union. I was saying once, halfly joking, that we are kind of the Jedis of the system, like the Star Wars, you know, saga, you know. But above all, the presidency is about trying to move forward the agenda of the European Union and act as an honest broker, aiming at achieving compromises and achieve as far as possible the overall objectives for the Union. For Cyprus, the challenge is even more daunting because, you know, we are a small member state, we are far from Brussels, we are a new member state, we don't have previous experience. We have a big national problem, and it's the most difficult moment in the life of the Union. So, economic crisis and, you know, concerns about the future, etc. So, it's not an easy task for us. At the same time, we are here and we have all the ambition and the political will to make a lasting contribution towards European integration. And at the same time, we believe that through working very hard for the European Union, we are going also to enhance the image of our country as a credible and responsible member of the EU, and also use this, if you like, in order to make sure that our society, our state, our public sector are more in tune with developments in Europe. So it's a formidable concentrate of experience for our country. It's a formidable concentrate of innovation and renovation boost, if you like, for Cyprus. We feel that we have the responsibility in this particular juncture to work towards delivering a better Europe for the next generations. And it is with this feeling that we're approaching our presidency. We have maybe the enthusiasm of a newcomer, and we have been preparing for this presidency for 3 years now. But we believe that during these troubled times of frustration and complexity, especially with the crisis in the Eurozone, and all those elements that led to an intensification of the debate on the future of the Union, and especially the institutional framework, you know, and these perennial debates about, you know, the proponents of more Europe, or the Eurosceptics, the proponents of a strong Europe against these aspects those are the subjects that are trying to dilute it, and you know, there is also these debates about widening versus deepening, etc. And also this recurrent debate about the multiple-tier Europe. It was important for us to focus mainly in these difficult times on working towards a better Europe. Better, you take it as you like, okay, but it has to be better. And in order to be better anyway, it has to be more relevant to the European citizens and the European Union has to be more relevant in the world. And our goal is to work towards a better Europe through adherence to fundamental values of the EU, solidarity, social cohesion, better quality of life for the European Union citizens, and our vision acquires a special significance, in particular in the current situation, because we believe that through this vision, we are going to offer hope and a more positive outlook to the citizens, especially the younger generations, assuring them that the troubles of today can indeed be overcome, leading us to a brighter future. So I would like also to say that rather than focusing on multiplying policies and actions of the European Union, we are going to focus also on effectiveness. We believe that we have a lot on our plate already, and sometimes what we need is proper implementation, and also when we implement policies, to have always in mind that what we are doing is that we are trying to move forward the European agenda and to increase the quality of life of our citizens. So this is the two areas where we're going to evolve, if you like, during the Cyprus presidency. Before continuing, I would like to join others in welcoming the positive outcome of the referendum in Ireland on the fiscal compact, which is for us all a vote of confidence for European integration and an important step towards recovery and stability. We are also on the way to deposit our instrument of ratification of the approval by Cyprus of the fiscal compact, and we hope that it will eventually enter into force as planned before the end of the year, I mean, 1st of January 2013. Cyprus, regardless of its own political problem, plans to proceed with a successful, result-oriented presidency, and will act in a purely presidential manner, and we will not allow our national problem to define our presidency. But at the same time, we're not going to allow our role as a presidency to be jeopardized by the Cyprus problem. The Cyprus issue and the presidency are two parallel and independent processes, and we will not accept have a second-class presidency due to our national problem and due to the stance of Turkey towards the Council of the EU. The drafting of our presidency program is completed. It was approved by our Council of Ministers yesterday. For this, we have worked hard among all the services of the government and in consultation with our partners in the Commission, the Council Secretariat, and even the European Parliament, and it's also taking fully to account the TRIO program. But we all realize and understand that to a great extent, the subjects that are discussed during a presidency, and more so now, are more or less predetermined. Since they are mainly issues inherited from previous presidencies, as well as issues stemming from the Commission work program for 2012. And even where, you know, and it always happens that you have unpredictable things that are happening, you know, it's not what you think. So you cannot really know exactly what you will have to do. What you need to do is just to have in place a system that prepares and gives you the right skills to work under unpredictable situations. And this we're trying to do. But at the same time, you know, we are very humble and modest in this regard. We hope that everything will work out well, but you know, we'll see. But despite of all the factors that I mentioned, each presidency still has some room of maneuver to give its unique touch to the presidency program. And the contents of our six-month program and our priorities will, of course, take into account the current socioeconomic developments and our own approach towards the issue. Let me say a few words about some of the issues that will be on our agenda. We all know that one of the key issues that will be on the agenda of the Cyprus presidency is furthering and eventually reaching political agreement on the new multi-annual financial framework covering the period 2014-2020. I mean, this is the ambition. I cannot say that it will be fulfilled. Maybe it will go a bit further to the Irish presidency, but we're going to work very hard at all levels in order to reach political agreement before the end of the year. And you know that the multi-annual financial framework is not just a budget for the Union for the 7 years to come, but it's at the end of the day, you know, the way we put our political and other priorities in all areas together, and it's part of the ambition we have for the future of the European Union as a whole. Therefore, it constitutes more a political and not only budgetary framework. And we need to have a clear understanding in which areas we're going to invest more or less in the future. And you know that now the idea is to every extent possible to link the discussions about the MFF with the ongoing discussion on how to reconcile fiscal consolidation with growth and jobs and all this is coming together, and we hope by the end of June in the European Council to have a better understanding on how do we do this link between the MFF and all the other debates about, you know, growth and jobs and the if you like, the pace of the necessary fiscal consolidation whilst we don't kill the elements of growth. And the MFF can be really of a great help and assistance in finding the right balance between these various elements. I don't know to what extent you have a clear picture on of the amounts involved, but the overall commitment ceiling proposed by the Commission for the 2014-2020 period is 1.025 billion euros, which translate into the amount of the last year of the current MFF 2013 multiplied by 7. You understand that this is one of the most sensitive topics under discussion in the European Union, and we need to find a way that will allow us to move forward, because the positions of member states are really divided. You know, without wanting to be overly simplistic, the main dividing line is between the net contributors and the net receivers. Even this divide, you know, has some further subdivisions, because not all of members of each category agree on everything. But overall, the net contributors try to bring the overall amount, the size of the budgets down. The net receivers, they want to stick at least to the Commission proposal. But as I was saying before, this fundamental divide, there are also debates according to various categories and headings of the budget. For example, countries with major stakes in agriculture and structural funds are less inclined to accept major changes in the composition of the budget. There is also an important debate, you know, about the revenue side of the budget, where we have, as you know, the proposals of the Commission on new own resources, which alter the stakes of member states in the income side of the budget. In addition to the differences between member states, there is another complication which arises from the fact that the European Parliament has the power of consent as regards the expenditure side of the budget. This changes fundamentally the negotiating arena compared to the previous multi-annual budget, because the Council will now have to also incorporate the opinion of the European Parliament. Hence, it is not surprising that this dossier poses the greatest challenge for the Cyprus presidency, especially considering that the original Commission proposal calls for a completion of the negotiations, as I was saying, before the end of 2012. The ambition we have, of course, on substance is to reach an agreement that will contribute to economic, social, and territorial cohesion. We will follow on the work that was accomplished by the Danish presidency, and you know that the Danish presidency managed to put together a very good negotiating box, which will be, it's under discussion, but will be discussed also at the end of June at the European Council, and then we're going to take it from there. This is very helpful to us, and we are going to use it as the fundamental tool in order to work for the successful completion of the negotiations. Then, going beyond the MFF, you know that in the light of the Eurozone crisis, we have all those issues of enhancement of economic governance, and we are going to place special emphasis in the implementation of the six-pack that reinforces the surveillance of fiscal and macroeconomic policies. And we are also have, you know, now pending before Parliament the two-pack, and we hope that it will be finalized soon, and we are going to work on their implementation. Of course, another priority for us is the implementation of the Europe 2020 strategy in order to help the EU to achieve high levels of employment, social cohesion, and sustainable growth. We are going to have to pay special attention to the enhancement of the single market, for which 2012 will mark the 20th anniversary. In this context, we will place particular emphasis to further deepening the single market through the promotion of the Single Market Act, and we are going to make every effort towards the adoption of the legislative proposals therein, as well as the responsiveness to consumer needs and to medium-sized enterprise, small and medium-sized enterprises' needs. The completion and full implementation of the measures for the reform of the financial sector is also crucial for enhanced surveillance of the market and for the efficient allocation of resources. So in the area of the financial services, the focus of the presidency will be on proposals relating to the revised rules on markets in financial instruments, on market abuse, and on credit rating agencies. And of course, we're going to try to bring greater market transparency and crisis management, you know, possibilities in the financial sector. Then we're going to place particular focus on policies for European citizens while addressing societal challenges and thus achieving more inclusive growth for the Union. Within this framework, we are going to place particular emphasis on providing employment opportunities and a more secure future to young people. Regarding the Common European Asylum System goal, which is one of the main priorities of the Cyprus presidency and is a commitment of the Union to finalize it before the end of the year, we are focusing on having the necessary legislative proposals adopted. There are four pending, but we are on track. The Danish presidency has done a very good job in this regard, and we hope that we will manage before the end of the year, though we all know that the political context is very difficult in this regard. And, you know, linked to this is also all the questions related to the integration of legally residing third country nationals. There is a lot of work to be done, and above all, we need to do, and this what we are trying to do during the Cyprus presidency, we need to do a lot of work for clarification of the different issues. It's one thing to talk about asylum seekers. There we have an international obligation under the UN Convention. It's another thing to talk about people entitled to international protection for humanitarian reasons because they are fleeing their countries. It's another thing to talk about illegal migration. It's another thing to talk about legal migration. And it's another thing to talk about, you know, the freedom of movement of European citizens. And you know that there is a lot of confusion around all those issues right now in Europe. And, you know, very often those recent phenomena of xenophobia in many European countries are addressed against European citizens from other member states. So we need to understand that what is at stake are fundamental values, and we need to be very cautious. So we don't expect or have the ambition to, you know, to set the record straight during our presidency on all issues, but we are going to work towards having more clarity and a better understanding of what is involved in the various debates around those issues. Then the presidency will focus on promoting child well-being through promoting recommendations by the Commission on child poverty. And we're going also to promote social inclusion of older persons, active aging, and the strengthening of solidarity between generations in the context of the European Year for Active Inclusion and Intergenerational Solidarity. In the field of health, the presidency will give emphasis to the issue of healthy aging for EU citizens, as well as innovative approaches to health care. In the fields of education and culture and youth, we place emphasis on the modernization of educational systems and provision of better education and to increase literacy and to provide equal opportunities for everyone. And of course, we have the ambition, and I think the Irish experience is very helpful in this regard, to work towards bringing closer the universities to the industry. We are going also to promote the proposed new legal framework for the protection of personal data, which consists of two legislative proposals, and we are going also to promote legislative measures focusing on enhancing cooperation between member states in the field of justice. There are Commission proposals that are still pending before the Council and the Parliament. We are going also to focus on further participation of civil society and further involvement of social partners, NGOs, and local authorities in the formulation and implementation of the Europe 2020 strategy. In the field of external relations, of course, we are going to strengthen regional cooperation with neighboring countries, and in this regard, we are going to place special emphasis to the southern dimension, the Arab Spring countries, and all what is related with our part of the world, without, of course, neglecting the Eastern Partnership and the other policies that are part of the neighborhood policy of the European Union. We want to bring the Union closer to its neighbors and have a better and more deep relationship with our neighbors, if you like. And we believe that the principle more for more needs to find its good expression in our external policies. We believe that what happened the last couple of years in our neighborhood should lead the way for us, because what conclusion we have drawn is that at the end of the day, we were taken a bit by surprise, because we had a single interlocutor. We had only the regimes, and we need to ensure that we have more channels of communication. We need to promote pluralism. We need to preserve all the communities in all those countries, and we need to avoid instrumentalization of the democratic process in order to achieve other aims. So it's a difficult task. It's something that goes beyond, if you like, the external relations, which anyway are within the competence of the High Representative, and we don't want to interfere with that. But we believe that there is a lot of room and a lot of ground to work directly with the societies and increase our presence and our possibility to positively influence developments in these countries. Then, of course, there are issues. I will come back to something that is neighborhood, but not exactly, which is enlargement. But I will come back a bit later to this. Just a word on the efforts to achieve sustainable growth and resource efficiency, highlighting the importance of a more competitive union based on a low carbon and green economy, and enhancing the ambitious efforts of the European institutions for more concrete results on this. And this is a compliment to the Danish presidency. We don't have any new to propose, but we are going to follow on the footsteps of the Danish presidency, which is doing an outstanding job on this area. As 2012 has been declared the year of water, the presidency will carry on work aiming at the sustainable use of water resources on the basis of Commission's blueprint to safeguard Europe's water resources. Then it is important for the Cyprus presidency to relaunch the integrated maritime policy during our presidency, and we expect that in October we are going to host a special event in Cyprus in order to adopt a special declaration in this regard. There are many other issues on trans-European networks, infrastructure, on transport, energy, and telecommunications, within or without the Connecting Europe facility that will be part of our program, if you like. But I don't think that I should go more into depth on those. If there are questions, I would be very happy to answer. And of course, as I was mentioning before, the presidency will carry on the work on the enlargement package. We believe that we need to keep the process alive, and the Union cannot just close the door. We need to be open, and we need to find ways to respond positively to the aspiration of those countries that have the vocation to join us in the European Union. We will ensure that the enlargement agenda remains high amongst our priorities, and we will therefore do our utmost to advance the process on the basis of the own merits approach, strict conditionality, of course, but also equal and equitable treatment for candidate countries and potential candidates. We expect in this regard to take forward the Iceland accession negotiations, aiming at bringing the process as close as possible to each to its conclusion, though we all know that there will remain a few chapters, let me say the most difficult chapters, to be negotiated under the Irish presidency. Moreover, the reinforcement of Turkey's accession prospects is of critical importance, and the presidency will focus on advancing this prospect in line with Turkey's negotiating framework and relevant Council conclusions. At the same time, we stand ready to cooperate in a constructive manner with the Commission on the issue of the positive agenda for Turkey in line with the conclusions of the December 2011 General Affairs Council. As regards the Western Balkans, we stand ready to contribute to the decisive advancement of Montenegro's accession course, as you know that there is a prospect there to open accession negotiations before the end of June, if everything goes well. The last day of the Danish presidency, we'll see if everything goes well. If so, the Cyprus presidency will continue the negotiations. Of course, during the Cyprus presidency will be more screening than real opening of chapters, so if everything goes well, we hope to be able to open a couple of chapters before the end of the year. There again, it will be up to the Irish presidency to take this over. Then we will see what happens with Serbia, which was granted candidate status, but we'll see if it is possible by the end of the year to have a decision on opening accession negotiations. Then, of course, we have a commitment to oversee, you know, that the accession process of Croatia proceeds well. There is already a number of ratifications, including ours. We will follow the monitoring process, and we hope that everything will go well and Croatia will join on July 1st, 2013. No much progress is expected on the other candidate countries for the time being. In conclusion, I would like to mention that our vision is to promote Europe as a hospitable space, we say in Greek, philoxenos topos, which in our, you know, interpretation does not mean only, you know, welcoming the foreigners and be hospitable. Philoxenos topos is part of our vision for our country, is part of the forethought for our presidency, is part of our aspiration for a better Europe. Philoxenos topos is part of our aspiration for a European Union which is more relevant to its citizens and in the world. Our vision is to promote the European space as a welcoming space for enterprises, for ideas, for services, for innovation, for culture. I would like to thank you very much once again for your presence here today.